Hello and welcome to the Penn State Abington LaunchBox event as part of Penn State's Global Entrepreneurship Week. I'm Peter Hornberger from the Abington LaunchBox, and we're going to be talking about brands and fans, particularly about Lego, building fan engagement with our guests Flynn DeMarco and Richard Board, who you may have first come across on the Lego Masters show that was on Fox earlier this year. So I'm going to work here to bring in Flynn and say hello, and there he is. Hello, Flynn. How are you?
Good, Peter. How's it going?
I'm great. Thanks for joining us. You might notice it's just Flynn for right now, but Richard is away on some business. So what we were able to do through the kindness and generosity of Flynn and Richard is to do a little bit of a recording. We're going to talk about that in just a moment. I'll play that for you all. And then we're going to have some time. Flynn has been incredibly generous, and he's going to be available for some question and answer. Flynn, hello and welcome. How are you, sir?
I'm good. Thank you. Thanks for having me. I'm sorry Richard couldn't be here today. Just, you know, one of those things. Had to go out and work. But I hope we did this video and we talked about some of the things that as artists inspire us. So I hope that there are things that you find inspirational as well. And I'll just say that finding Lego as a hobby and then being on Lego Masters and then now having, a YouTube show and sort of a platform to do that on was really important to our lives as artists, having moved from theater into more live theater into more sort of focused hands-on art at home, you know, as opposed to on the stage. And it was an amazing journey for us. It's actually still going on and evolving, but it's been really exciting.
Good. Yeah. And so what we'll do, we're going to get into some more content with Flynn and Richard here in just a moment, but I want to give you some context for this medium that we're on. This is a YouTube live stream. This is actually the first YouTube live stream we've done at the Abington LaunchBox. And Flynn, you're doing this four times a week, which is both impressive, a little bit scary, and overwhelming as well. But just to give you kind of the lay of the land, one of the things you can do, particularly if you have any kind of Google account, so Gmail or a YouTube account, on the right side of your screens, there is a chat function. And if you have questions or comments, you can populate that area with some of those. And like I said, around 1:45 p.m., Flynn is going to be here to answer and address some of those questions and comments. We also have our faithful chat moderators, both Aiden Pooley from Penn State Abington is there, and Flynn Julia Hornberger is also on the line as well. So she's helping out managing the chat, and I'm sure Andrew is somewhere in the mix as well. But what I want to do, as we get the video started, since this is Global Entrepreneurship Week, where Penn State, we take a look at ideas like entrepreneurship, innovation, creativity, and arts, we want to also bring in this global aspect, which, Flynn, you're coming in live from Oakland, California, so
that's right.
Not quite proximal to Pennsylvania, but we see Libby and Sophie are already saying hello, so this is perfect. Please use that chat function. But what I want to ask is, if you could maybe give us an idea of where you're tuning in from. So, you know, maybe city, state, and my hope is, since this is Global Entrepreneurship Week, there are some people outside of the country as well. So as we get ready to roll into this video, again, please feel free to use the chat function to send some comments or questions that you might want Flynn to address at 1:45. And also let us know where you're tuning in from. I think it would be interesting to see. So Flynn, I am going to take a leap here and hopefully play this video. So we'll be back with you all live in just a bit. All right. So I want to say hello to Richard and Flynn. Welcome and thank you for joining us.
Hi. Hi. Good to be here. Yes. Thanks so much for having us.
No problem. I guess I should say the traditional tricky bricks and tricky lug hello, which is ahoy hoy.
Ahoy hoy.
All right. That is one of the ways that Richard and Flynn start off their show, which they stream on YouTube four times a week. These guys are excellent at engaging and talking to the audience, which is why we thought they'd be not only a great guest here during Global Entrepreneurship Week, but also the medium within which they work, which is Lego, is also a space that captures many minds and attention. So again, thanks for coming, but why don't you kick us off with talking a little bit about your background experience, and that includes Lego, but also beyond. You obviously are doing more things than just Lego. So give us a little bit of an idea about Richard and Flynn and what makes you great spokespeople for engaging through artistic medium.
Sure. Flynn, do you want to go first? Sure. So I have a long history in the arts pretty much my whole life. I've done a ton of theater. That was really my main thing. But I've also, played musical instruments and sing and paint, and I've really like dabbled in all of the things. But really theater was kind of my main deal, and that's how Richard and I met, was through doing theater. So pretty much, and I've done some teaching and some summer camp work with kids on various subjects. Again, theater, puppetry, cool. Lego, all sorts of different activities. So that's kind of my quick background. Well, I've been, I guess Lego-wise, I started as a little kid. I used to get sets for every holiday, Christmas, birthdays, all the time. And I don't remember ever getting a themed set. They were always really just bricks. So it was heavily involved in building what I could come up with, as opposed to, I don't remember ever following instructions for sets. And my mom really encouraged me for artistic pursuits my whole life. So since high school, even before, I've been in theater. And I have a bachelor's degree in theater with a minor in communication. So those two things have been very important to me. I think a lot about communicating clearly with my art. And then about 5 years ago, Flynn got me a little X-Men Lego set for my birthday, because he thought it'd be a fun thing we could do together rather than, staring at a TV screen. So we got that and we liked it. And then very soon he got a 20-pound box of just mixed up Lego, and we dove in and started building stuff.
Somebody's collection on like Craigslist or something, they were getting rid of it and it was cheap and it was a lot of Lego, and we were, we only had the one set, and I think we were really inspired after just building that one set to kind of build our own things. Okay. That almost immediately, I feel like we just jumped right from that first set right into to mock building, or that's what we call my own creation in the Lego community. That's a term we use. A mock is a model that you've done that's not a set, basically.
Good.
And we were used to figuring things out ourselves, because we never had big budgets for theater, or rarely had big budgets. So we made a lot of stuff out of what we had around, and we've done the same thing with Lego. Although it's been kind of like, I don't know, we dove in deep.
Yes, for sure.
Yeah, I was gonna say, I think when there's a point when you start buying Lego by the pound or the kilogram or the pallet, that's how you know you're getting in a little bit heavy and but at the same time, it's a medium and an art that you're growing with it. I guess is, as you're expanding your collections and buying more things, it's because your skills are growing and your interest is evolving with that.
Definitely. And of course, there's always the, like, you just really want that one thing. But we definitely, as you pick up and learn things, I think that's... as you pick up and learn things, you want to try, you're like, oh, this was a really cool thing I saw that somebody did online. Now I really need to get those specific parts so I can try doing that myself. Or I think one of the more fun things that I've tried to do, and it's not always easy, is to kind of go back and try and recreate something that you've seen somebody make online that looks relatively simple on the outside, and like see if you can recreate sort of reverse engineering pretty much something that you see. As a matter of fact, I remember at the very beginning of the year, there was somebody doing that as a challenge. Like every day they would create this kind of you know, complicated little puzzle of a Lego piece, and then post a photo of it, and then challenge people to try to reverse engineer it and create their own. And I thought that was a really interesting way to engage.
You know, it's something I found really attractive about the Lego community, the community of people who build with Lego, whether they build sets or build their own things, is this massive sense of collaboration. That people are really, really willing to say, look, I made this cool thing and this is how you could do it too. Yeah. There's a lot of that sharing. And so it makes this sort of, design really just goes through the roof when you've got all of that support, rather than, especially at conventions or online, rather than people being like, oh, you can't do what I do because I'm the best. People just really lift each other up in great ways.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I mean that's really one of the focal points of this Brands and Fans workshop series is how are these businesses fostering and creating an ecosystem like you're describing? And while we're not looking at this necessarily from the perspective of Lego, the company or the brand, they're obviously a part of your lives and lots of people's lives. And I think as consumers, and I think we're more than that, we're fans, I think you guys are probably ambassadors at this point, whether it's a literal or figurative word. You're broadcasting that message four days a week through your YouTube channel, this is something that I think intrigues me. Is how do you perceive this? I mean, Richard, you were just talking about this concept where you're at a convention and there's collaboration, there's sharing, there's openness. But at the same time, there's many places and spaces where, particularly in business, that people want to close off and be secretive. But at least my perspective, my biased perspective, is that I think there's much greater creativity. There's greater productivity. Things are so much more amplified to the positive when there is that openness and collaboration. Can you guys talk a little bit more about the community of Lego? The individuals, we can talk about adult fans, and you guys can share some more acronyms with people. We probably need to create a glossary, but can you talk a little bit about that kind of the culture of some of those that do build and work with the Lego medium?
I have some thoughts about that. Do you want to go first?
No, you can go ahead.
Okay, well, as far as creativity and sharing, I think it's built into Lego. And I don't mean to sound like a commercial, but I am a fan of it. Not only am I a fan, but I use Lego as my medium for my art. I'm a theatrical lighting designer, and I also do set design. But lately, I've been doing a lot of that in Lego. And I think from the very beginning, as a company, Lego fostered creativity. It said, you can use these things to make what you can imagine. So it started with that, and I think it over decades drew a lot of people to that who said, yeah, we can make really cool stuff with this. And then they started clubs and joined together, and I think it just started with that and sort of like a fountain just flowed down. Mm-hmm. What do you see?
Yeah, well, I think that, and also Lego is, as a company, especially recently, very much more engaged with their adult fan base. Mm-hmm. You were talking about acronyms. So AFOL is a commonly used term that means adult fan of Lego. There's also TFOL, teen fan of Lego, KFOL,
kid fan of Lego.
So there's already, they've definitely, in recent times, become more engaged with their fan community. I feel like in some ways it kind of took them a little bit by surprise. Mm. I mean, I think they knew that there was an adult fan base, but I want to say that I think around the time that the Lego movie came out, the first one, was when it really, I think, hit them that it could be something more than just what's classified as a toy. I mean, there was already a lot of fan photos and models obviously out on the web, especially on the internet, especially on Flickr was a really big home base for a lot of people who were doing Lego work. and just coming up with these amazingly creative and just outrageous models, like the things that you wouldn't use. How did you even come up with that, first of all, much less build it out of square bricks? And they've really started engaging more in a marketing way as well with their adult fans. Just in the last, I want to say, 6 months, they have, and this was, you know, completely unrelated to, you know, people being at home, locking down and all that stuff, but they really started, they've started a line with specific packaging aimed towards adults. So their normal packaging is very, you know, lots of bright colors, lots of yellow. If it's the city sets, lots of blue, pictures of the models on the front. And for the adult, you know, like the adult packaging, they've gone with this very slick black, like black box with an image on it, with a little thin strip that runs across the bottom of the box that has a close-up of Lego bricks, like a picture of Lego bricks on it. It's really packaged like something you would put a shelf on and put a spotlight on in your house, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
As opposed to taking apart and playing imaginative, you know, games with.
Yeah.
I wanted to, I didn't mean to, did I cut you off?
No. We've been at conventions where we've spoken with representatives from Lego who were there just to see what people were excited about, what they were doing, what new, you know, things were happening with the fans. And there's also, there's LUGs, which are Lego user groups. And those are sort of club, well, I'm sorry, of course.
No, I'm laughing.
Who am I telling?
No, Lego is, I guess, because Lego really is the sort of like the home of the acronym. There's so many.
But so in various ways, Lego offers direct support to these clubs and really like helps them not only reach out to people, but do more with Lego. They're, I find that they're really, really supportive.
Yeah. Yeah. That's good. So one of the things that I wanted to do, I have some students that are really excellent students, but they're also, they have connections to Lego and art and artistic expression. So instead of me asking all of the questions, I'm going to bring in just a couple of students. So give me 1 second to get them.
So yeah, my name's Nino Fendich. I'm a junior here at Penn State. My Penn State story started at Abington, where Mr. Hornberger is, and currently I'm finishing up my bachelor in mechanical engineering here at University Park. My passion is drones. So in my free time, I work on my drone services company, Aerial Prospects. But when I'm not studying or working on my business, my Lego of choice is Technic.
Yay! I'm not surprised somehow. My favorite.
Yeah, it kind of makes sense. But yeah, so my question for you, Richard and Flynn, is how do you think a system of rules and structure like Lego is can impact and possibly amplify creativity?
Want to start on that one or shall I?
You can.
I'll start on that one. We heard in art school that an artist's limitations are their greatest assets. And I think that's true with rules in a design system. There are certain things you can do with paint that you can't do with pencils, that you can't do with Lego bricks, or vice versa. They all have their strengths. And I think the fact that you can't, for instance, with Lego, you can't mix a red and a yellow brick to make orange, but you can put them next to one another. So the ways that you work with color when you can't actually miss them or mix them are entirely different. And I think from an engineering standpoint, Lego provides a lot of challenges because you can't glue, you shouldn't glue anything, I think. And it doesn't bolt down. There's nothing fixed. You have to make sure that all of your tolerances are just right so there's no friction. And all of those limitations, I think, guide design in a way that makes it peculiarly Lego, but also still a really good way to model the world. Was that sort of to
the point? That's a great way to put it. That's, yeah, kind of what I had in mind too. Yeah.
Well, and I mean, from my perspective, it's those, because I'm that way, those rules and systems make me want to break the rules and system to try and create something else that you're like not supposed to do, if that makes sense. There's lots of rules, at least in the Lego fan community, about like, you know, there's
what they call an illegal connection. So you're not supposed to put it that way because Lego doesn't do it that way. They don't allow that in their sets. But I feel like as an artist that you should be able to, you know, if I want to, you know, put those two things with one stud and bend it that way and it's not supposed to be that way, well, that's okay. If it achieves the end that I'm looking for in an artistic sense, then I'm okay with bending those rules, as it were.
You know, one other thing that comes to mind is sometimes it helps to not know all the rules.
Yes.
I think as a lighting design technician, in my professional work, I feel like I have to understand the engineering rules. I have to know what's safe, but I don't have to know what all the other designers are doing. I can come up with my own. And what happened with Flynn and I is we started building before we knew that we couldn't do some of the things we were doing.
And we did them anyway.
And we did them anyway. And then we learned new techniques. And then once we learned the official way to do it, we learned how to make it so it wouldn't also, you know, fall apart.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I think when you look at Technic, that's even more so. You have to follow the rules. You have to follow that Lego look. And it kind of makes you think more about how you can be creative and how you can kind of hide the more mechanical things behind some cool design or kind of push those limits.
Yeah, that's a big, that is definitely a big challenge because as you know, working with Technic, so there's Lego system, what they call system, which are just, you know, your bricks and all your regular, and then there's the Technic, which as you know, is slightly different and it's actually off the system. It's not exactly the same, you know, like things land halfway between where you would expect them to be on a regular brick. And so that creates its own challenges. And also, like, if you go even further and you look at Mindstorms, which is Lego's like robotics line, that's its whole own other system. I mean, yes, it also incorporates system and Technic in it. But what we noticed when we first started, and I feel like it's changed a lot since we first started in the hobby, even just in the last 5 years, is that like Technic and system and the robotics were all sort of separate compartmentalized things. Like if you bought a Mindstorms kit, it's because you were making robots. If you bought a Technic kit, it's because you were making a crane or a car or one, or, you know, and then if you were buying system bricks, then you were probably buying a building or, a boat or something. And then we found that, we started animating our models using Mindstorms kits. So we were using, we ended up incorporating Technic and Mindstorms and system all together to create like one giant final piece. And it was very challenging, but also extremely engaging.
The one other thing on that, if I'm not taking too much of your time, is I think a very important element in many systems, and specifically with Lego, unless you're very wealthy, is scarcity, right? Mm-hmm. You only have the bricks you have. So you have to solve the problem with not only the colors you have, but the shapes and parts that you have.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's especially applicable to aeronautic design. Like if you're making a moon rover, you know, you may not be able to make it 10,000 pounds. You may have to have, you know, a limitation on how much weight you can have. And I think that kind of scarcity with Lego is applicable many places.
Well, and speaking of the moon rover, the chassis for the first Mars rover was designed in Lego first. And we've actually met the guy who designed it. He goes to conventions and has his models, and we've talked to him a few times. But yeah, he designed it in Lego first, and then they actually executed the model on that chassis. I always thought that was really cool.
He could just do this rapid prototyping. That was awesome.
Yeah.
Hi, yes, I'm Calista Weigel. I'm currently a business management student at Penn State Abington. And my question was basically, would you say that learning to build Legos using the instructions is similar to using old master's paintings when learning how to paint, or is there a different creativity to it?
I can see that. I could see that relationship, definitely. I mean, the
one of the things I was mentioning before was that we purchased and built one set, and then we went out immediately and just, I bought somebody's collection on Craigslist. So it was just a giant tub, right? Like basically.
And we didn't know what half the pieces were.
Yeah, we didn't know what half the pieces were, but to us it was like art supplies. Like I didn't see a bunch of Lego. I saw a bunch of art supplies. And we started trying to just sort of teach ourselves and build our own things. But then what I came to discover and really appreciate, especially I think in the last year, especially, is that there is so much knowledge to be taken from building a set. There are so many things you can learn. And definitely in the last year, and we've interviewed a couple of Lego designers who have said that this is true, but Lego's really upped their game in the kind of complicated methods that they use to put things together to create interesting shapes, especially in the last year.
A lot of math for ratios with things and just making them fit super tight.
So being able to, I mean, you can see this Hogwarts Castle model in the back, this back behind us, was a fascinating build for me. Like I built it, it took quite a while, it's huge. But I learned so many things about building in that particular style. It was really fascinating. And of all the sets I've put together, that's probably the one I've learned the most from. So I definitely say yes, like you can, any Lego set, even if we just buy the set because we want some of the parts in it to build something, I will always build it first because there's always something that you can learn from it.
Well, that's really cool, yeah.
Oh, sorry.
No, yeah, that's really cool. I mean, I took a painting class in college and that's kind of what got me into that question was that we did a lot of old master painting to kind of learn about different styles and learn about different versions of people's drawings of things, which helped us kind of learn what our own style was.
I think that's, oh, sorry, you go. Oh, no, I would say it's really interesting because one of the things Lego does too is revisits certain sets years down the line. I mean, especially when you're talking about like Star Wars, I don't even know how many Millennium Falcon models there have been, but they improve upon them every time. And again, I mean, to kind of come back to the Harry Potter thing, like they are right now doing a bunch of new Harry Potter sets, and they did a bunch of them in 2010. And then they did ones even before that. And they, like the Burrow, the Weasley's house, they did a version of it. And then they just released a new version of it, which is so much more accurate to the movie. Like the construction of it is much better. And you look back at the older one and it was nice, but you can see where they really took artistic license with a lot of the things that they did with it. And we actually spoke to the designer who designed the current one. And he said that he looked at a picture of the old one and then that was it. Like he didn't, you know, he didn't feel beholden to what had gone before, but definitely made it his own while still being true to the original form. I just thought that was that's a really interesting thing that they do when they remake things.
I think understanding the history of the medium that you're working in, as well as aesthetically understanding the history, like how did people use paint? How did they use light in their piece? You know, how did they communicate perspective? How did they communicate weird perspective? It means that you don't have to do all that experimentation from scratch yourself. You can learn from, you know, like with Lego, people have been doing this for decades and decades and made some really cool things. You know, and if I start from scratch without any of that knowledge, it may take me a while to learn that this clip goes on this bar and that they even fit together. And I think the same is true with paint. I think of about Picasso, and Picasso knew how to paint and he knew perspective and he knew his brushes. And yet after he learned all that, he decided that aesthetically he wanted to do it this way, and that made his signature look. But he learned his tools. I mean, I don't know what his educational history was first, but he learned his tools first.
Some of the things that you brought into some of the conversation about, when we're talking about business and entrepreneurship, just the thought of having to accomplish a task with scarce resources and trying to figure out how can I get to the destination given the set of resources I have at hand today. is such a great metaphor for what it's like to start a business, which is if you're always waiting to have all of the pieces that you possibly could need to build your destination, as you guys know, you're always short, you know, one or two parts that you do. It's always, yeah. If I only had this one thing, then I would get it done.
Yeah.
But if you were always waiting to have it, how would you ever get started? So I think that's a great metaphor, Richard, that I've never been able to put into words before.
I don't know if it's exactly, it might be a little bit of a tangent, but a friend of ours who's a brilliant programmer and maker, Amy, talks about the iterative process of mm-hmm. design, whether it's engineering or building with Lego, that you don't necessarily have the perfect answer at the start, and you may not know how to get to the end, but if you know the next few steps, you can just keep iterating and iterating and changing it. But it means that you have to be flexible, you know, about your design. There may be more than one way to reach those goals.
Yeah, that's great. And again, if you were talking in front of an entrepreneurship class right now, which you may actually very well be pretty much about, where this, hopefully there's plenty of entrepreneurship students watching, what you're talking about is probably exactly what they're hearing in from their entrepreneurship professors as well. I hope that's what my students are hearing, is that this is an iterative process. Even if you figure it out today, eventually you're going to learn more and you're going to figure out, oh my gosh, why would I have done it so inefficiently like I did it before? There's a much better way. I just didn't know until I got to that point. So it's very similar to the world of business and entrepreneurship.
Ooh, maybe I should start a business. Yeah.
Yeah. We might. So let's transition to getting down to wrapping up. You guys have given a lot of time and great wisdom and insight. But one thing we didn't really touch on yet is where do you draw your inspiration from? You know, where does the spark come for you guys to constantly be creating, but also engaging, right? Like we talked about, we also want people to watch. You're available on YouTube multiple days a week. You're engaging, you're informative, educational. I can't even tell you, as someone that obviously is a fan not only of Lego but of you both, Richard and Flynn, how much myself and my family have learned, not just about Lego but about engaging, about being human and connecting with other people, particularly when we're distant. These things all came through a YouTube show and obviously the show on Fox, but you guys are really inspirational to many of us. And I'd just like you guys to maybe talk about what are some things that have inspired you and continue to inspire you?
Wow. Well, I mean, from an artistic standpoint, just like things that inspire me to build, or what, like, you know, what ideas I have. I say this all the time, but it's true. Like, every movie, every TV show, every piece of music that I've ever heard, like, they all come into play. Like, even if I don't realize it at first, I will often find myself building a model and getting done with it and going, oh, right, that is that thing. And that's the thing that I remember from that thing. And that's that interesting shot I saw in a movie that kind of had that one thing in the background. And I'll find that I've just sort of like mixed all of those things in. And I mean, it's interesting because not only did our show started because of the lockdown, honestly, like we locked down. I was an educator. I taught Lego after school classes, like STEM classes for kids. And we would use Technic motors. We would make cars that moved. Like, we did, a lot of stuff. And so that was, I found the kids super inspirational. The stuff that they would come up with, and the stories that they would come up with that went with the things that they built, were always just so out there and perfect. And sometimes I just wish, like, wow, I wish I still had that, like, freedom of mind to just, like, go to those places. I don't know, when we started doing the show, a lot of it was because I really missed that interaction with the kids. I missed that education. I missed that teaching people how to do, you know, teaching somebody how to do something for the first time. I just thought it was really exciting. And of course, we were starting to lock down, and I, you know, like no one else decided ever to do a YouTube channel while we started locking down. So I'm like, oh, I know. How about this? Oh, right. The thing everybody else is doing. I mean, it was crazy when we first started. Like, we couldn't even find a webcam online to like start streaming with because, you know, lockdown had just started and everybody was buying a webcam and we didn't have anything, but we decided to do it anyway.
Scarcity.
Scarcity, exactly. But I'll tell you, like Boone, who we were on Lego Masters with, is hugely inspirational to me. He is another person who's extremely engaging, extremely into talking with his audience and always cheerful and in a good mood. And I don't know, I find him really inspirational. And I think it also, of course, we're not doing theater right now, so it was like another outlet and a way to engage in an audience. And we had to learn, or at least I had to learn a different way of communicating through performance, right? So because the performance is so much about being there and the relationship between you and the audience and your, or, you know, I should say live performance is so much about that interaction between you and the audience. And then suddenly being in a medium where, you're talking to a camera and there's just a chat, you know, window on the side. It's a little disconcerting at first. But I was really inspired by Boone and by Mel and some of the other, you know, I went through a lot of, like looked at a lot of YouTube channels. And, you know, as we know, the internet can be a bit of a cesspool sometimes. And it was, I found a lot of negativity on, you know, there's so much negativity online, like just in general. And there was, I noticed a lot of sort of negativity around YouTube and lots of people grousing. And I was like, you know, we really have so many other things to worry about right now. Just creating a safe place where people can feel creative and feel a part of something while we're all separated was really important to me. And I met with a friend, Yano, who is a really talented Lego builder as well. And she was saying, well, what do you want to do? I was like, I don't know. We were thinking of starting a YouTube channel. You know, we were on Lego Masters and we were kind of wanting to feed off of whatever, you know, from after the show, like maybe we could start a little something, see what was going on. And she just started, she's like, well, tell me a little bit about like what you kind of like to do. And she kept writing, you know, while I was talking, writing things down. And when I was done, she's like, well, here's a list of the things that I, from listening to you talk, that I feel like your channel would be about. And she, you know, she said, you know, creativity, positivity, and connectivity, and sort of a unity theme, like a let's all create something together. And I really took that to heart when we started our channel. So those are the things that that I find inspiring. Well, creating other people inspiring other people to create inspires me in return. And it's just like a perfect symbiotic relationship, in my opinion.
I have a lot of the same pop culture inspirations that Flynn has. We both like spooky movies. We have similar tastes in music. For me personally, for my own design and building work, whether it's building with Lego or designing lighting for theater, I go to art history and architecture history a lot. I like, if I find a theme, and it's interesting, well, it's interesting to me, as a designer, I am often not creating, as a lighting designer, I'm not creating my own vision. I'm actually interpreting someone else's vision in this medium of light, right? So it's not all about what's inside and what everything I've done before. Every project is new. So if the subject, you know, is trees for that play, then I'll go and I'll look at the history of how people have represented trees. And I'll also look at botany pictures and, well, I mean, that's okay. That's a very basic tree.
It's not a tree. It's a fiddle.
It's some bricks. Anyway. I'm sorry. It's some bricks. But I'll do that. I'll do new research for every new project. And, you know, I'll decide maybe I want this one to draw from Art Nouveau, but I want it to have, you know, I want it to have the weight of this other, you know, maybe brutalism, right? And see how I can make those two things match. So I go through what I think that would, I don't know what an Art Nouveau brutalist building would look like. I think it would be
a little disturbing.
That would be very tough.
And haunted.
But I'm constantly inspired by what people have built before and by large sort of groups of design, whether it's surrealism or, you know, Renaissance Dutch masters painting. And I come back to those again and again and again. And I also find inspiration from other people who are really strong in my field. I study, you know, the best lighting designs. I study, and plus I'm a fan too, right? I just look at cool builds.
Yeah, I mean, that definitely, you know, my Instagram feed is almost entirely Lego models. So I, you know, other people's, like going, I follow a lot of people there. And that is definitely, you know, you were talking about community. That is definitely a huge source of inspiration. The Lego community itself is just so, and especially now that we don't have conventions to go to, there's so much stuff that you can go online and just look at and be blown away by and inspired by. And like Richard was saying earlier, so many people in the hobby are so free and open with help. And I mean, when we did our really, really complicated model, it wasn't just us. Like we had like three other people that we sort of talked with that helped us through certain areas.
Really brilliant programmers and engineers.
Right, and the result was, you know, something that was pretty fantastic, but it wouldn't have happened without that community aspect, for sure.
You know what? No one is asking me to give advice, but if I could be so bold as to give one piece of advice, I would say whatever field it is you're working in, I'm a big fan of apprenticing to people who have been doing it for a long time. Don't be afraid to ask for help. Don't be afraid to look for mentors who are really good at it and find people and surround yourself with people who want to collaborate with you more than they want to compete. And, you know, it's just like rocket fuel. It's amazing. I don't know. That's what
I'm right in line with you, Richard. I feel that is, it's great. So absolutely. So what we'll do is we'll kind of get close to wrapping up because you are inspiring, I think, many and with all the different things you talked about and how much all of this connects to so many different fields. And again, it's not necessarily just about the medium of Lego. It's not even necessarily just about art. But now we're talking about expression, connection, communication. And that is something that I think is just human nature. And again, one of the things that I truly appreciate over these months of being in lockdown and quarantine and work from home is that humanity kind of gets lost when you don't interact with other humans as much as you did. And one of the things that I think really drew us in amongst, again, the millions upon millions of options that are out there, there was something about not only the concept that you were talking about Lego, but how you were engaging with your fans in that medium really, really made a lasting impression on myself, my family, students like Nino, Calista as well. So I really want to thank you guys for being an inspiration to us as well.
Thank you so much.
So as we wrap up, what I just want to ask is, my guess is my hope is that you've made connections to someone watching, have said, wow, this is something that resonates with me. There's a connection here where I feel energized and motivated and inspired by listening to what Richard and Flynn have to say, by looking at the works that they have on Instagram. So where can we find more of this? Where do we direct people so that they can actually see more of what you guys are doing?
Sure. We're on Instagram. We're on YouTube as Tricky Bricks. It's all one word. There's also trickybricks.com. We have a website. Right now we do 4 days a week on YouTube, Monday, Wednesday, Friday, and Sunday. We do weekly build challenges. And then on Fridays, we do like a slideshow presentation of all the builds that people have sent in and talk about them.
Mondays are often how-tos.
Yeah, we try to do how-tos on Mondays. Wednesdays are just kind of like sometimes building a set or like talking about a subject. And then our Sunday shows are a group chat where we have other Lego builders on to talk about whatever weird Lego things we decide to talk about that week. There have been long discussions about art. There's been long discussions about minifigures. It really, you know, it runs the gamut. And of course, there's the inevitable rabbit holes that we sort of go down, lots of pop culture rabbit holes on the way to whatever subject we're talking about. And then, like I said, we're on Instagram and then on Twitch occasionally when I'm feeling like I can be on camera again, I do a Twitch stream. And that's Twitch, goodness, that's Tricky_Bricks. That was like the only place we couldn't get just regular Tricky Bricks. But that's where I do stuff. Our show on YouTube is really more entertainment variety show almost, the way we run it. We have like little features and we do Lego news and talk about, you know, we give our dog a cookie, which has turned out to be the most popular thing on the show, I think. Like, the Twitch show that I do is really a much more focused kind of like Bob Ross builds Lego. Just like we just kind of sit around and like, okay, now we're going to put this together. And we usually do bigger models on that show.
It's so, a little bit of calm.
Yeah, it's a nice little bit of a little bit of calm.
That's good. So I'll wrap up. At least I have no more questions. But are there any other things that you might want to throw in, share as we get ready to wrap up here with our session for the day?
I have one. So I talk a lot about art history and engineering and all of that, but I like playing with Lego. I like using Lego as my art medium because I like playing with Lego. It's just and I think about that with my other mediums too, is just I like play. And it's so much more fun to play through a design than work through one.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I totally agree. It is a fine day when you can learn and play at the same time. And I think there are two things that ironically, as little ones grow up, we tend to shift them away from play and more towards learning, and we separate those two things. And again, I just believe that those two things are best kept as close together as they possibly can be. And that's one of the things that I really, really value about Lego, is that there is learning embedded in the play so naturally and seamlessly.
Right.
And I think that really is one of the things that makes it such an engaging medium. And I've kind of taken on your, I know it's not your invention, but the concept of I'm buying art supplies as opposed to I'm buying, you know, toys to buy and fill my shelves and build with. But it's art supplies, but it's also a learning medium. It's a connection medium, communication. And so I am really amazed that a small plastic brick is a great way to connect people and cultures and all these things happening all across our towns, our countries. You guys are in Oakland, California. We didn't even talk about that the way from Oakland. Probably something that wouldn't happen if it weren't for some of the things that are going on with lockdowns and distancing. Yeah. So while there's lots of things that are probably not wanted and definitely not planned, there's also this chance to reset, refocus, and take advantage of some of the opportunities that we have now. So I'm again thankful for your time, your energy, and your sharing, because I think you really are great educators as well as great artists and great people, as far as I know. Top notch, A+, and people that I'm happy that I've gotten at least a chance to share some time with today.
Oh, awesome. Thank you so much. We like you a lot. Thanks. Your talks.
Thank you. I greatly appreciate it. So we'll wrap up there, and we'll let you guys get on with your evening. Okay, we're back, everyone, live, and thank you for sending in some great questions. So, Flynn, I'm going to bring you back on with us live here in just a second. So welcome back, Flynn. So thank you, guys, for that time. But we've got a bunch of questions that came in. And Flynn, I don't know if there was one that you wanted to start with or not, or if you want me to kind of feed some to you. What do you prefer?
You can ask the questions in whatever order you see fit.
And sure. Oh, good. So I'll try to take them in a bit of order as they came in, and you guys are still welcome to continue to ask questions. But during that video, you and Richard talked a little bit about the rules that come along with Lego. And I guess the question from Robin Smith, so thanks again, Robin, for asking a question, is a little bit about... have you ever kind of caused more problems by breaking rules, where maybe you solved one small issue, but then maybe because you stepped outside of the system, it wound up creating a larger issue later?
Oh yes, absolutely. And I'll preface this by saying we didn't purposely break the rules. They were rules that we when we first started, we didn't sort of understand. I mean, we took on Lego Technic, which is pretty complicated, fairly early on, because we had bought pieces in a bulk buy, and there are definitely rules surrounding Technic that we just didn't understand about the placement of pins and where things have to go to be able to make them fit properly with the regular Lego system. And we just, on our very biggest piece we've ever made, we just kind of started building randomly with Technic, and then it was fine up until a certain point, and then it got really big, and Richard is very precise about things, so he got a level out, and he's like, I just want to make sure that the top of this is level, because we had all these platforms that were moving and adjusting and everything, and the whole thing was like slightly off. And it didn't seem, that's the trick about Lego, like it doesn't seem like it's off at the beginning, but it creates a lot of problems further down the line. So definitely there were a few times where if we, but then I will say the result of that is that we learned the rule, and that's not a mistake that we'll make again.
Good. So another question that came in, this one is from Sophia. Again, during the video, you talked a bit about some of the different LEGO acronyms and LEGO communities. So AFOL, Adult Fan of LEGO, those kinds of things. But the question was, is there a such thing as an EFOL, elderly fan of LEGO, particularly with some of the potential benefits from things like puzzles and actively engaging different segments of the brain as people age?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I'll definitely say that, first of all, that Lego can be very effective for older people, especially those with Alzheimer's. And I have a friend who goes and does a Lego program in nursing homes and has to great success. I will note she uses Duplo, which is the younger kids version of Lego. It's like bigger bricks, but they're easy, you know, they're easier to accommodate for some elderly people who might have trouble with, you know, fine motor function, that kind of thing. But as to your question, I don't think there's, I know that like AFOL, TFOL, and KFOL are sort of like the standards, and then there's a lot of other, I don't know of an official EFOL, I'm sure there is one, but I do know that there are a lot of people who sort of make plays on the acronym. So like I know that there are some older builders at one of the conventions I go to that call themselves Grayfoles. So and then there is on Facebook, there is a safe space for LGBTQ plus builders called Gayfoles. And there is a group called the Women's Brick Initiative that they use Waffles, W-A-F-O-Ls. While there may not be an official one, there are a lot of sort of plays on the acronym that takes place in the community.
Cool, thanks, Flynn. All right, and then a question from Callista, who was actually in the video with you guys. But Callista asked, do you have a favorite or an inspirational movie that you connect with? And I know that this is probably one of the more difficult questions we could ask someone like you with so many influences coming from popular culture. But can you think of something, it doesn't have to be the one, but something from a movie genre?
Sure, I will say, if I had just like off the top of my head, because I do have so many inspirations, and I do find so many things inspiring, and sometimes it's like one tiny scene from a movie, like a much longer movie. Like I know one of the things, and I don't know why it affected me so hard, but there's in the Alfred Hitchcock movie, Rebecca, at the very end, the very final scene, there's this beautiful tracking shot that tracks the outside of the building, Manderley, as it's burning down. And, you know, Mrs. Danvers is on the inside and you just see her silhouette against the flames. And this camera tracks around and tracks her movement through the window. And then you kind of get the corner of the building and you come back to the window again and she's back in the frame again. It's just a beautiful scene. And I remember the first time I ever saw that movie that I just rewound and watched that one because it was on videotape. I rewound and watched that scene over and over and over again because I just found the framing of it so fascinating. And so that's an example of just like a scene in a larger movie that I find inspiring. And then like if you're going to talk about movies as a whole, Disney's Sleeping Beauty is a masterpiece of art, in my opinion. It is beautifully rendered. I have it on Blu-ray, and if you look at the backgrounds of that movie, they are stunning. They're stunningly done, really amazing art style. This guy named Ivan Earl is who was responsible for a lot of the looks in that movie, and he has a very distinctive style that you may recognize if you see, if you're familiar with Disney movies, like especially in Sleeping Beauty, he like square trees with rounded corners, like that was like a really big deal. And his art is hugely influential to me. And also Mary Blair, who was another Disney artist, a very famous, one of the only female Disney artists. She had a lot to do with Alice in Wonderland. So I guess you could say as a whole, I find a lot of the original classic Disney films to be inspiring for so many reasons, innovation, animation, art style. But Sleeping Beauty holds a special place. Like I went and saw Ivan Earl's work at the Disney Family Museum here over in the Bay Area. And it was incredible seeing not only his work for Disney, but then his own personal work, which of course was infused with all of his style and that same sort of just beautiful, interesting shapes and colors together. And it was a hugely, hugely inspiring art show for me.
Good. All right, a couple more questions and then we'll wrap up for the day. But this one came in from Stephen Thatcher, and he wanted to ask, and I think timely, if people go back and watch some of the Tricky Bricks episodes on YouTube, you'll find that we talk about a lot of the concepts that were discussed, but this one I think was just on Sunday. So Stephen asked, is it important for LEGO to market to an older audience, and how might they best go about doing some of that?
Oh, sure. Well, that's a really great question because that's actually happening right now. So in the past 6 months, LEGO has really started sort of targeting the adult market with much more sophisticated builds and even just the general tenor of their newer sets are more complicated and interesting builds rather than just putting, you know, regular bricks together. There's lots of little tricks and interesting pieces and interesting techniques that they use to appeal to an older audience. And also they're clearly marketing to adults via nostalgia. Like there's an NES set that just came out. There's a Sesame Street set that just came out. They're really focusing on that. And I think that's great because I feel that you know, as we go on and we become older, we lose that sense of play, and especially that sense of play as a learning tool. I think that we lose that because you look at something like Lego, and when I first started out in the hobby, I will admit, like, I was already like in my late 40s when I started in the hobby, and it was, I found, you know, sometimes it was embarrassing. Like, I felt very sheepish when somebody'd be like, so what do you do? I was like, well, you know, I build Lego models. And then, you know, people were like, okay. And then as soon as I started winning awards and I could kind of point to that I had won trophies, then people kind of took it a little bit more seriously. And then, of course, once I was on Lego Masters, then all of a sudden people took it very seriously. And I think it's important too, because Lego in particular is not just a toy. Like I think we mentioned it in the video, but we see it as art supplies, right? Like that's the thing, the tools that we use to create our art. So I think that's important. And I think that too many, as we grow up and get older, we often dismiss those things as being too childlike, or those aren't the things that we're supposed to be thinking about when we're adults. And in my opinion, we have enough to think about as adults. So why not enjoy creative play? Like what's so great about building a Lego set is, even if you don't build your own models like we do, like if you just build sets, there's something so satisfying about sitting down and with a pile of bricks, and at the end you have this like 3D detailed little art creation that you've just made. And maybe you didn't create it from scratch, but you made that out of that mess of bricks. And I can promise you that there are some of the way that the instructions are done, it's a miracle if you actually finish the set, and especially some of the more complicated ones. I guess, yeah, that would be my answer to that. I think it's very important that we all maintain that sense of play and education. And I think that Lego is, of course, they're focusing on that because they're a company who is, their goal is to make money. But I think also their goal is to bring people in, educate, create, and inspire people onto bigger things. And I think that's a really amazing, amazing thing for a large corporate company to do, in my opinion.
Yeah, and I agree. And I share with my students all the time that you can be profitable and still support the community and promote really positive messages so that those two things don't have to be opposite ends of a spectrum. And oftentimes the better the business functions, the more they can amplify some of the positive aspects that come from that.
Is it okay if I address a question that I saw came
yes.
real quick? I know we're getting towards the end
here. Go ahead. But,
So we haven't specifically talked too much about our YouTube channel, mm-hmm. but Sean David asked, is most of your subscribers are other people you collaborated with before or talked with? And also, how did you grow your channel? That's a really good question. I once we were on Lego Masters, we had a pretty large platform. So once I was able to just get our names out there, people sort of just gravitated to see what it was we were going to do. And of course there were a lot of friends, and I went on Facebook and I was like, hey, please subscribe to our channel on Facebook. And a lot of people did it through that. But I will say that the two things that you've asked are sort of incorporated in that. One of the ways that's really great to help grow a channel is to collaborate with other, YouTube creators, or just other creators in general, because I noticed that we get a bump every single time I'm either on someone else's show or I have someone on as a guest. So like Boone from Lego Masters has a very successful show. Every time I'm on his show and I mention that we have a channel, we automatically get new subscribers, like every time. Same thing with having our channel host sort of like intro how-to kind of classes, like one session type deals. Whenever we have a guest speaker who comes on to talk about a particular subject, new subscribers. So I really think, there's many, many ways to do it and lots of factors, but collaboration with other creators is one of the best ways to grow, your channel.
Good. Yeah. Thanks, man. Go ahead. Anything else?
And then Aiden Kelly asked, if there was one takeaway you would want to leave everyone with today, what would it be? Well, there's a couple. I can never just name one thing. But and these may sound really simplistic, but one of the first ones is, don't be afraid of failure. If I gave up after the first time I put two bricks together and it didn't work out the way I wanted it to, I would have never been on Lego Masters. I would never have a channel. I wouldn't be sitting here talking to you. And like I mentioned earlier, failure was the way, by, a mechanic that we worked really, really hard on not working for 3 months and going through the many failed iterations until we finally landed on the right thing. I learned something from every single one of those failures. So don't be afraid of failure. It's you almost have to at some point or another if you want to be able to progress past a certain point. And then the other one would be just go out and build and create. Like, there's nothing more satisfying than creating, in my mind. There's nothing more exciting than creating. And if you can go out and create something beautiful for yourself and other people to appreciate, then you've done a really successful job at creation. I guess that would be it.
No, that's a great way to wrap. And thanks, Aiden, for kind of sealing it up with the final kind of question. And what that just triggered in my mind, Flynn, I do a lesson on the leader as creator. And typically we think of creation as making a thing, right? We had a bunch of little Lego blocks and we turned it into a 3D model of a car, a house, the Harry Potter castle, whatever that might be. But there's also creating culture, creating feelings, creating connection. And one of the things that I really think that you and Richard do an incredible job of is not only creating things out of Lego, art and beautiful things, but you create connection points. And I'm hopeful that those that watch today found something that they could connect with, be inspired by, and take as a lesson, not only from what you're doing here, but also from the concept of why do we do Global Entrepreneurship Week at Penn State? It really is to be the point where you can find inspiration, whether you're a college student, a member of the community, someone that's never touched a Lego before, someone that's never started a business before. The hope is that you can find that there's common ground all throughout this, and that we can find inspiration in many places. And the hope is that we as Penn State people can put together a series of events that someone can find something that resonates with them. So I am greatly appreciative, Flynn, of you and your time, and please reach out. Flynn just put in the chat the different spaces and places that you can find them. Because there's lots of great content, and you're also welcome to follow the Abington Launch Boxes, where we're working as much virtually as we can to create more content like this to be available to you all, to engage, inspire, and connect. So Flynn, as we wrap up, I'll leave it to you to say any final words before we wrap and end for the day.
Sure. I'll say, I mean, if you are interested in creation and sort of dipping your toe into the Lego world, there's a lot of stuff out there. And we do, on our YouTube channel, we do weekly challenges. It's a total no judgment zone. We have everybody from kids all the way to older adults on all levels of talent and skill. And it's a great place to kind of get your feet wet, try out a challenge, turn something in, have everybody see it and kind of be excited about it. And it's, I think, a really positive way to get started. So definitely, I'm sorry, I know that sounded like a shameless promotion, but that was really more, really just to kind of say, if it's something that you like, try it out. Check it out. There's lots of ways that you can go about it and find out things that are comfortable for you. I just know a lot of people have a little nervous about sharing the creations that they've made, and they feel like, well, I'm not really an artist. And I just want you to know that there are places online where that's not an issue. You know, like I said, don't be afraid. And you know, maybe the thing that you made doesn't look great to you. But if you show it off, somebody else might find something extremely, and probably will, inspirational about it.
Great. Well, thank you, Flynn. And thank you for joining us. And send my regards and all of the regards from anyone that was here to Richard as well. And we greatly appreciate the time. So thanks, everyone. And we hope you enjoyed that time with Richard and Flynn and our talk about Lego, innovation, creativity, entrepreneurship. So enjoy the other Global Entrepreneurship Week activities all throughout the week from Penn State. So again, thanks all. And Flynn, thanks again. We'll see you sometime soon.
Yes. Hope to see you soon. Bye, everybody. Thanks so much.
Bye, all.